الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الأبرار يشربون من كأس كان مزاجها كافورا، عينا يشرب بها عباد الله يفجرونها تفجيرا، يوفون بالنذر ويخافون يوما كان شره مستطيرا، ويطعمون الطعام على حبه مسكينا ويتيما وأسيرا، إنما نطعمكم لوجه الله لا نريد منكم جزاء ولا شكورا. صدق الله العظيم. When a person loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, naturally this person would love everything that is connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we talked about a few of those things in the past sessions. But normally, when we think about loving things that are connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, generally, only few things would come to our mind. If we would think about it, we'll say, okay, masajid or Quran and these type of things. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Quran al-Kareem and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in hundreds of his ahadith have shown us a much larger picture of this than what we normally could even think about. And that is, when a person loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this person should love the creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because they are created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is Allah's creation. No one created these things but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that connection of Khaliq and Makhluq is there. And because of that connection of Khaliq and Makhluq, this person would love all of these things because they are the Makhluq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In this regard, if we start looking at the ahadith and at the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we would find amazing examples. Things that normally does not even click to us that this thing could be part of my deen. This could be part of the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes we may think being nice and loving, it's only for people that we know, people around us. And if a person goes beyond this, we'll think it's only for believers, for Muslims. But when we look at the ahadith, we would see that this type of connection of love with people is not only, in fact, with Muslims, it's even with non-Muslims. And it goes beyond that. It's with animals, with all the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a hadith in Kanz al-Ummal. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be ordering someone to Jahannam because of his deeds, because of his amal. As this person is being led to Jahannam, he will look back. And then he is going to call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his rahmah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call the person back. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say to this person, are you looking for my rahmah? Yes, Ya Allah. I'm looking for your mercy, for your rahmah. He knows his a'mal will never get him there. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to him, okay, I will have rahmah on you. But the only thing you have to do now is just bring something, show me something that will witness for you that you had rahmah with that person or with that thing in this world. If you had rahmah on anything, on a person, on an animal, anyone, just come and just show me that and bring that as your as a witness for you. And if that thing will witness for you, I will have my rahmah on you. To that extent, then the hadith says, Rasulullah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to him, وَلَوْ عُصْفُورًا. Even if you can bring me a small bird that you had mercy and rahmah on it, I will have rahmah on you today. And there will be some people who won't even be able to bring a small bird that they had rahmah on it. That they had mercy on the bird. Scholars have collected the hadith that talk about being nice, kind, and having rahmah with animals. And only with these ahadith, with the collection of those ahadith, we find 70 different type of instructions of how to be nice to animals. Not 70 ahadith. There are hundreds of ahadith. But when we take the rulings out, there are 70 different types of rulings that people we can derive from the ahadith that are about just being nice to the animals. How to treat animals and how to be nice to animals. Today, although there is a lot of claim of it, and then there are organizations and societies that work only for protection of animals and making sure that the animals get their rights and they are treated well, but still, we don't find really, people don't even have a clue that any of that information does exist over here. And still we don't find anything closer, anything that comes close to the instructions and teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All the people working on it for years and years, putting all of their time, energy, effort, and they're doing nothing. They're doing nothing in their life but working in this field. And still they are not able to give the animals the rights that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam have mentioned in the hadith. Just a general example. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, on the day of judgment, when a person will call for the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at that time, some of the birds or some other animals will come and they would request Allah not to have rahmah on this person. And then that bird, that animal will claim that, Ya Allah, this person, he hurt me for no reason. He didn't want to eat me. He didn't need my meat. He had no use for me. And still he hurt me. And still he killed me. And we see people enjoy going fishing. And there is a restriction of how many fish you can take out. But there is no restriction on how many you catch. Catch them, put them back. Now, after having all of those hooks into this fish, and the fish is bleeding, the person only cares about his $2 hook. He's going to pull it out as harshly as he can. And the animal is wounded, is suffering. Sometimes the animal swallows the hook. Sometimes it sticks so badly that it does not even come out. This person doesn't need this fish. He's just enjoying it. You're going to take it, throw it back. Then get another one. Hurt it, throw it back. The person is enjoying it. And it's allowed. But here we see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam telling us, this is not acceptable. That just for our own fun and enjoyment, we hurt the animals. نهى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يتخذ شيئا فيه الروح غرضا. That something that is alive, that has a life, to be used as a target is haram in Sharia. Don't be just targeting animals for no reason, just for fun. If you need it, go ahead for it. But if a person doesn't need the animal, doesn't need anything from this animal, has no use, only for fun, this is another one. So rahmah, being kind, having mercy, not only for human beings, even for animals, is part of the teachings of our deen. It's not something extra. It's not an addition to be nice, now we have to do these things. No, this is part of our deen. Even these things will have a claim on the day of Qiyamah. These animals will be coming to witness for or against the person on the day of Qiyamah. And it's a well-known hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there was a woman who committed a lot of sins, all kind of sins. Finally, one day, she is out in the jungle. And she was thirsty, so she went to a well and drank some water, got some water for her soul. And as she walked away, she see a thirsty dog. The dog was eating the mud out of thirst because there is no water, so he's eating the mud. This woman, she takes her shoe off, ties her shoe with her scarf, and then she lowers it because she's using the scarf as a rope, and she gets some water in her shoe and provides the dog with water. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, فَشَكَرَ اللَّهُ لَهَا فَغَفَرَ لَهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appreciated this deed from this woman, and he had forgiven all of her sin. All of her sins were forgiven because of this deed. Imagine the rahmah that this deen is teaching us. What's the extent of rahmah that this deen is teaching us? That it's not only that she got 10 rewards, she got 50 rewards. Subhanallah, what can be greater than having the maghfirah of Allah after spending the whole life in those sins? What are we trying to do with all of our ibadah? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, through the rahmah, through that kindness, people will achieve and they can achieve these things. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave another example, the opposite of this. This woman was very kind. She spent her whole life in sins, but here, because of her kindness, because of her rahmah, on the khalq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on these animals, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had forgiven all of her sins. On the other hand, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَدَخَلَتْ إِمْرَأَةُ النَّارِ فِي هِرَّةٍ رَبَطَتْهَا. And another woman, who was good, virtuous, she ended up going into Jahannam because of a cat. Just because of one cat. She tied her cat and the cat into the house. فَلَا أَطْعَمَتْهَا. She did not feed the cat. And she did not even allow the cat to go out and eat on her own. And that cat died. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, because she made that cat suffer, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threw her in Jahannam. In spite of her a'mal. There is a hadith which is known to be mutawatir bil awlawiyyah or musalsal bil awlawiyyah. That normally this is the hadith, the first hadith muhaddiseen teach their students. And this is why it's called bil awlawiyyah. It's the first hadith that normally muhaddiseen will teach their students. A sahabi heard it the first time. When a sahabi went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the first hadith he heard from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was this hadith. Then he met his students, and this was the first hadith he taught his students. And that chain continues up to this day, that muhaddiseen teach their students this hadith, they said with this hadith to be the first hadith. And that hadith is, الرَّاحِمُونَ يَرْحَمُهُمُ الرَّحْمَانُ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى. Those who have rahmah, Rahman subhanahu wa ta'ala will have rahmah on them. Irhamu man fil ard, yarhamkum man fil sama. Have rahmah and mercy on those who are on this earth, the one who is up will have mercy on you. To get the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, have rahmah and mercy on people around you. This is something that we really need to work on ourselves, to teach ourselves this lesson of rahmah, of kindness. And generally, of course, if we look at ourselves at this time, each and every one of us would feel, including myself, I feel, that you know, I have a lot of rahmah. We have a lot of kindness. I'm very nice. You don't know how many times I just forgive people. And I just control my anger and I'm about to say something and I don't say it. So I have a lot of rahmah. Imam Tabrani, rahmatullahi alayhi, narrated a hadith with sanad sahih on the authority of Sayyidina Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu. He says, when we heard so much from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about rahmah, so one day we said, Ya Rasulullah, kulluna yarham, we all have rahmah, we all have mercy in our heart, we all feel that we are kind and nice. In fact, this is something we may try, that just think of a person that you think it's very temper and hard and harsh or whatever word you may want to use for it. And then if you talk to that person about kindness and mercy, he will feel, yes, he is the one that you're talking about. And his feeling would be that, I don't think anyone is kind, more kind than I am, so the whole talk was only about me, it suits me the best today. And this is our feeling. One day, a person went to his sheikh, and he started saying things in the same lines, along the same lines, where it was like almost his admiring himself. So the sheikh told him, he said, it's so nice to hear all of this from you, but what I would like to do is, after salah, get up, right after salah, and make this announcement that I want everyone to tell me what do they think about me. I want people to tell me what they think about me. And he said, once people will tell us what they think about you, then we can make the right decision about what you really are. And we know that my opinion about me may be totally different than what everyone else's opinion about me. I mean, they may say, mashallah, very nice, virtuous, good person, knowledgeable, but when it comes to dealing, I have to think about it. If I have to do a business with you, if I have to deal with you, if I have to ask you for something, I'll have to think 10 times before I would approach you. So, it's not what we think of ourselves. It's what our behavior is and accordingly how people will think about us. I'm sure I have mentioned this before, that sometimes we get impressed when a few people admire us about something. Someone tells us, you know, you're mashallah so great and I feel okay. I got a certificate today. And similarly, once a barber goes home and he says to his wife, he's very happy and he must have done something to displease his wife. So she says, I see a big smile in her face, what's that from? He says, you know what? I'm the best barber in the country. How do you know that? Today the king called me and I did some work for him. I was dressing his hair, and when I did it, he said to me, you are the best barber in the country. The king told me this. But he says, what does the king know about us? He's a king, he's not a barber. If all the barbers will tell you that you are the best barber, then I will accept it. But if the king is telling you, he doesn't know anything about this field. So when people like us would tell us, MashaAllah, you are very religious. I say, oh, MashaAllah, you know, I'm very religious. And I will tell him that, MashaAllah, you are very nice and you are very religious. And he goes back with the same certificate. We give certificates to each other. But let's spend time around the mashayikh, around the scholars. And then see where we fall. So this rahmah is especially something where everyone feels. A person who goes home and he's just, the family is tired of him. Children are just waiting for a phone call that I won't be coming tonight. And they will be celebrating. Even with that type of person, he feels that no one is better than me when it comes to being nice and humble and merciful and kind. So rahmah is really something like that. That everyone has that feeling about him. And with all of my temper, I would say, yeah, I'm very tempered. And I get angry. But at the same time, I'm very kind too. That's our feeling. So anyway, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Ar-Rahimun yarhamuhum ar-Rahman. If a person wants rahmah from the Rahman subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has to have rahmah on the creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A person who does not have rahmah on Allah's creature, that person will not have rahmah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the key. Ar-Rahimun yarhamuhum ar-Rahman. Those who have rahmah, Rahman will have rahmah on them. Those who don't have rahmah, they are losing that rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يرحم من في الأرض يرحمكم من في السماء. And inshallah we'll talk in more detail about this topic, that the way we treat others, this is how we would be treated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are so many hadith that talk about this. As this hadith about rahmah, have rahmah on others, Allah will have rahmah on you. Forgive others for their wrongdoings, Allah will forgive you. Cover up people's sins, Allah will cover yours. There are a lot of hadiths that tell us that the way we treat people, this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will treat us. And it's all about that kindness, that rahmah with people. And if we look into that hadith, we see that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, really his great quality was his rahmah for his ummah and for the world. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he wanted to tell us in Quran about a special quality of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And another ayah, بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. This Ra'uf and Rahim, both of them are the attributes of Allah. Allah is a Ra'uf. Allah is Rahim. And both of these are used for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that bil mu'mineen Ra'uf al-Rahim. And in fact, in another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that it's only Allah's rahmah on you that He made you so soft. وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْ فَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. If you were hard and hard-hearted, غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ, hard-hearted, لَنْ فَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. People would have gone away from you. They would run away from you. But here we see that people are coming to him, صلى الله عليه وسلم. زيد رضي الله عنه, who lost his parents in his childhood. After so many years, his parents find out his whereabouts, and they come and look for him, and they talk to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about him. Ya Rasulullah, will pay you any price. Ask for whatever you want, any price you want, we'll pay you, Ya Rasulullah. But give us our son back. His mother is waiting, brothers and sisters are waiting, all the relatives are waiting. Everyone is waiting to see Zayd. Father and uncle and his brother, they went to bring Zayd back home. Imagine what would be the feeling of this boy, of this young man, who have seen his father after so many years.
And his father is telling him, for all of these years we have been crying for you, Zayd. Where were you? We are looking for you. And Zayd, we have a good news. We talked to the Prophet. We could talk to him at this time, they're calling him Muhammad. We talked to Muhammad about you. And he says that we offered him any price he wants for you. And he said, no, he doesn't want no price. He's willing to let you come with us for free. He doesn't want no price. He says, just take him if he wants to go. But if he doesn't want to go, then don't force him. And you know, Zayd, for sure, you would like to see your mother. You'd like to see your brother and sister. You'd like to come back to your home. And to their surprise, Zayd says, no. Dad, I'm sorry. But I prefer to stay here. Imagine, at least, it would be the child's choice that, okay, let me just go and pay them a visit and then I will come back. Ya Rasulullah, just give me 2 weeks. I will be back in 2 weeks. No, not even this. Doesn't even bother like going there. I'm going to just stay here. I choose to stay here. No, his heart did not shake up at all after what he had seen over here. He had seen everything. I mean, he's not missing his father. He's not missing his mother. He sees all of that over here in Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine what type of thing he must have seen over there, and he got what type of love he must have got from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they told him, do you accept to live as a slave over here rather than coming back to your hometown? And his father was one of the leaders over there, and he lived with all the luxury of the life and everything. He said, yes. The thing that I'm getting here, I will never get it anywhere else in the world. A villager comes to Medina Munawwara. And he's not too aware of adab, of akhlaq. After talking to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he goes in one of the corners of the masjid and starts urinating there. And we know what would be our attitude towards that type of person who's not urinating, just doing something wrong. Sahaba radhiyallahu anhu ajma'in rushed to stop him. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا تجرموا دعوه. He started already. Don't disturb him. Leave him alone. He started already. That corner of the masjid is already najis now. So now, for us now, we will be just reacting to our emotions. Say we stopped him. What did we get? It's already najis there. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no, just stop. When he was done, then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called him. And he made him sit. And now he's explaining to him. He says, look, these masajid are not built for these type of things. We are not supposed to do these things in the masajid. And he talks to him nicely. When this person realized the importance of masjid in Sharia, he was so surprised. He says, I swear by God, I have never seen anyone that is more kind and more rahim than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine, who would have more respect for a masjid than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And if a person is really worse to be get emotional or to just react upon his emotions, that would be the situation. But no, even at this time, his rahmah, his kindness for the person is greater. He says, leave him, let him finish, and then we will deal with the situation. A person comes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, young man. He takes the shahada, but he says, Ya Rasulullah, I have one problem. There is one thing I can never give up in my life. What is that? Now just think where he's sitting. He's not just sitting in a masjid. He's sitting in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The sahaba are sitting around. He is talking to the Prophet of Allah alayhi salatu wa sallam, to the purest person in the world. And he says, Ya Rasulullah, one condition and one thing. Don't tell me to give this thing up, because I won't and I cannot. What is that? my habit of committing zina, wa ayyaz billah. Sahaba were so upset. How could you even use this word over here? In this pure and clean gathering. How could you even use this type of word? They won't even think about something like this in that gathering. These are the people, when they're sitting there, they're seeing Jannah and Jahannam with their eyes. And now you're bringing this, saying a word like that in this masjid, in this gathering, in the presence of the Prophet ﷺ. And one of the Sahaba says, we are about to jump and just pull him away from out of the masjid and teach him good lesson. You know, we may not even have that feeling, because these people were very pure now. And we have no clue how much they hated these things. So, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard this from the Sahaba, from this young man, and he saw the reaction of the Sahaba, he said, let me talk to him. Then the Sahaba says, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gets me to sit very close to him, where he puts his hand on me, just showing his rahmah. He puts his hand on me and he says, listen, would you like someone to commit the sin with your mother? No. Never, Ya Rasulullah. I can't even think about it. Okay. How about someone doing it with your aunt? No, Ya Rasulullah. With your sister? No, Ya Rasulullah. With your daughter? No, Ya Rasulullah. He says, then, when you go out and commit that sin, that would be someone's daughter, someone's sister, someone's mother, someone's relative. You don't like it for yours, people don't like it for theirs. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam put his hand on that person's chest and he made dua for him. This young Sahabi says, since that day, not even by mistake, I never looked at non-mahram in my life. Now just imagine coming to Sahabi here, pick him up, throw him out of the masjid. Person is gone. But this is the rahmah. This is where we see the real rahmah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. But the point, we are not talking about that quality of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The teaching is, this is the teaching of our deen. If Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was rahmatul lil'alameen, that tells us something, that this ummah has to be the ummah of rahmah also. We are the students of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We are the followers of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Our harsh treatments, our treatment where we show attitude to people that drive people away. This is not part of our deen. This is in fact against the teachings of our deen, against the ways of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We see how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhi majma'in to treat animals. And not only animals, sometimes when you have your enemies, people treat their enemies worse than they treat animals. But if we look at the treatment towards the enemies in the hadith, you will see that it was a treatment where it looks like a person is dealing with someone who has done great favors to him. He is not an enemy of yours. At any situation when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had control over his enemies, he always treated them better than they were treated, when you could even say, by their own people. After the Battle of Badr, one of the Sahaba from Ansar says, I was sleeping in a tent next to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's tent. Nighttime, we were all so happy because of the victory, and we kept on talking about it, then we went to sleep. But as my tent was next to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's tent, I kept on hearing the cry from the tent of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Someone is crying. And it came to me that it has to be Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I got up, I couldn't take it. I went to him. I said, Ya Rasulullah, are you crying, Ya Rasulullah? And I saw the tears in his eyes. So I said, Ya Rasulullah, today is the happiest day for us. It's such a happy day that we never expected such a victory. With all of this help of Allah, Ya Rasulullah, we see a big smile on everyone's face. What makes you cry, Ya Rasulullah? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the thing that is worrying me is that when you people were tying these 70 people that are the captives of war, I don't know if you have tied them too hard and they may not be able to have rest at night. This is the thing that is worrying me. This Ansari says, I said, Ya Rasulullah, okay, I'll take care of that. Right away I went there and I saw that some of these, those people were really tied up very hard. So I started loosening those things and I went back and informed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Ya Rasulullah, now they are at comfort and they are all, Ya Rasulullah, saying that they are happy in the position they are in. Only then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to sleep. Just think about the rahmah. And this is the teaching, this is the teaching of our deen. That we should have the habit of kindness, of rahmah. So I was mentioning the hadith of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu. He said, Ya Rasulullah, kulluna yarham. This hadith in Tabrani. Ya Rasulullah, we all have rahmah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no, laysat rahmatu ahadikum sahibih. I'm not talking about having mercy and kindness towards each other, towards your people that you know. وَلَكِنَّهَا رَحْمَةُ الْعَامَّةِ I'm talking about having rahmah on everyone, on all the people. That what people are going through is not what my relatives, what my friends are going through. When there is a woman crying somewhere in the world, that thing disturbs me. That thing should disturb me, that she is like my mother. She is more like my sister. This is just like my own son. And he's suffering. أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ Have you seen a person who rejects the Day of Judgment? Have you seen a person who rejects the Day of Judgment? A question from Allah. فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُ الْيَتِيمِ That is the person who rejects the orphan, does not help the orphan. No rahmah even for the orphans. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with His rahmah and give us that kindness, that softness of the heart, that we have shaqqa, we have rahmah, we have kindness towards all the creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we always treat people in the best way, that is the best way of treating others. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of us and have rahmah on us also. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.